Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. I would like to share a few thoughts about how we can develop a stronger relationship and a closer relationship with the Qur'an. We know that this is the month of the Qur'an. This month of Ramadan is the month of the Qur'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Qur'an, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. The month of Ramadan that the Qur'an was revealed in it. And so we know from looking at the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he focused more on the Qur'an during this month and read it more, twice with Jibreel alayhi salam. We find the early generations, the Sahaba and the Salaf, they would read the Qur'an in other parts of the year, but they focused and they turned their focus onto the Qur'an. And this is something that I found when I was studying in West Africa in the Mahdara of Murabit al-Hajj. One of my teachers, before Ramadan came, when it was my first Ramadan, he asked me, he said, Rami, what are you going to study in Ramadan? And I had not thought about it the way he was looking at it and the way the culture there, drawing from the early generations, is. I said, well, I'm going to continue studying my fiqh, the book that I had started. He said, Rami, this is the month of the Qur'an, and so I encourage you to memorize Qur'an. And if you're going to study something else, have it about purification of the heart. And that's what I did. I memorized Qur'an during the week. And on the weekends, I did extra readings on books on purification of the heart, the tongue, specifically by Shaykh Muhammad Maulud. It's a book that I was going over in the Halaqa series before the lockdown there at MCC and the community. And it was the best Ramadan ever, or one of the best Ramadans ever that I experienced. And so every Ramadan, we should do whatever we can to turn our lives back to the Qur'an, to recite it more. And each person is going to have a different way of turning to the Qur'an. For some people, it's reciting it themselves. For some people, it's learning how to recite it. For some people, it's listening to it. For some people, it's studying the tafsir. For others, you know, whatever it might be, every Ramadan, we should draw that much closer to the Qur'an. And again, it can be in many, many different ways. What I wanted to share in this these series that I'm going to do, this will be the first of four videos, is to talk about one element of the Qur'an that really amazed me when I learned about it. And this is something that we have to remember, that according to one of the sayings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Qur'an has secrets that every generation will uncover some of those secrets. So we know that in terms of rules, ahkam, and belief systems, i'tiqadat, and you know, our aqidah, those have already been derived. We don't have to approach the Qur'an and say, oh, what this hadith means is that there are rulings that can change, or maybe the earlier generations didn't know about it. No, we know that the rules were already discussed. But there are other subtleties. There are other subtleties of the Qur'an that every generation, there's something that you can uncover in your generation. So when you approach the Qur'an, approach it like that, like it's an adventure to try to find out what is another mystery or a secret of the Qur'an that I can have access to. So what I wanted to share with was about this concept called ring structure or ring composition, which it's studied in literature in terms of looking at literature, whether it's biblical and religious texts, or even if it's literature going back from the Greek literature onwards, but looking at how things are presented. And when I first heard about it and started looking at some of the verses and how they show there's this mirroring pattern to the Qur'an, it really blew me away. And there's a number of articles, we'll link some in the description in the video here. But if you look at some of these images, and even if you're watching the video now, I know some people like to multitask, you can put ring structure Qur'an or ring composition Qur'an and just type on images and look at the images of some of these. I'll be discussing too, Surah Al-Baqarah and Ayat Al-Kursi, about this during this video. So what the idea is that when you look at the Qur'an, there is a structure to it. You know, sometimes some people, when they start reading the Qur'an, especially if they're coming from other traditions where they see the Bible being presented in a very chronological order, then they come to the Qur'an and they see, well, why does it move from here to there? It moves in a different pattern. But there is a pattern, and some of the early scholars noticed this, and they wrote books about this. Al-Razi wrote about this, and others, they noticed that there are patterns, and so they started trying to identify what are their patterns. Like if you notice at the end, at surah, in the last juz of the Qur'an, juz amma, a lot of the surahs are actually in pairs, and so each surah matches up in terms of the theme with the surah that goes after it, and this is why some of the scholars said it's good to recite surahs from that juz immediately after each other so that we can keep the structure. So to jump right into Surah Al-Baqarah, and we've just gotten through finishing this Surah Al-Baqarah a few nights ago, and it's the longest surah in the Qur'an, but there is a theme there. There's many themes there, but let's look at it the way that the researchers who are looking at ring composition or ring structure in the Qur'an. So what ring structure is you look at, it could be A, B, C, D, C, B, A, or A, B, C, D, E, D, C, B, A. It goes down, and then it goes, and then it mirrors itself. And so the A's, in terms of themes, will match up, the B's will match up, the C's will match up, the D's will match up, and if it's E. And then what they're showing too is that the core central theme that is there, everything's leading up to that central theme, and then it mirrors itself back. So let's look at Surah Al-Baqarah. We just got finished listening to it or reading it in our Taraweeh prayers just a few nights ago. So the first theme in A is believers versus disbelievers. So there's that presentation of who are the believers and the disbelievers. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam challenges the disbelievers to produce a surah, and God gives life and resurrects. So that's A. Basically, the idea of believers and unbelievers. Let's go to B. B is Moses delivers law to the children of Israel. So we hear a lot of those stories. We are hearing the stories of Bani Israel and Moses' interaction and going to the mountain and coming back, all of that. So he's delivering the law to the children of Israel, and the children of Israel, they're reluctant to sacrifice a cow. That's B. Then C comes as Ibrahim was tested. There was the test of Ibrahim. The Kaaba was built by Ibrahim and Ismail. And they make a prayer that their descendants submit to God. And they actually make a prayer, which is the prayer of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why he says, I am the dua of my father Ibrahim alayhi salam. So that we got A, believers versus unbelievers. B, Moses and delivering the law to Bani Israel. C, Ibrahim was tested, he builds the Kaaba. And D, this is the central element, or this is where it begins to mirror back. The Kaaba is the new prayer direction built by Abraham and Ismail. The Kaaba is the new prayer direction. This is a test of faith and encouragement to compete in good deeds. So if you remember, the original Kaaba was for the Muslims to face Jerusalem. And the Prophet, it was hard for him because he loved Mecca and he wanted it to turn back. And Jerusalem is sacred to who? To the Muslims, but also to the Bani Israel. And so now Allah was telling us about Bani Israel and the story of Bani Israel and the tests that they experienced and what they went through. And their Qibla, which is Jerusalem, now for the Muslims is changed to the Kaaba. So that's the central is the changing of the Qibla. Now it mirrors backwards. So the next C, Muslims will be tested and instructions about pilgrimage to Mecca and warning not to worship ancestors and multiple gods. So this C goes back to Abraham because it says Muslims will be tested and the instructions on the pilgrimage to Mecca. Well, the first C was Abraham was tested. See, Muslims were tested. Abraham was tested. The Kaaba is built by Ibrahim and Ismail. And it's mirrored in that next one as the instructions on the Hajj and not to worship the ancestors, meaning Allah is telling the Arabs, stay on faith because that's what your grandfathers, Ismail and his father, Ibrahim alayhi salam, that's what they were calling you to. And then B, the next B, the Prophet delivers law to the Muslims. The first one was Moses delivers law to Bani Israel. And the Muslims are encouraged to enter Islam wholeheartedly. And this mirrors the theme or the subject of the Bani Israel being followers of Musa and believers in God, but they also when they were ordered to slaughter the cow, which the surah is mentioned after, they didn't do it. So Allah is telling us, this is what Bani Israel did. They were submitters to their religion, but they didn't submit at that moment completely. So we want you as Muslims to submit completely. And then A, believers encouraged in the struggle versus the disbelievers. So some of those early interactions between the Muslims and the disbelievers, the Quran is telling us to have that steadfastness. And then Ibrahim challenges the king, the rising of the sun, and then God gives life and resurrects. So this A at first was believers versus disbelievers. The prophet challenges the disbelievers to produce a surah. Ibrahim's challenge was Abraham challenges the king to affect the rising of the sun. Try to do that. Because the king asked him, what is your Lord? My Lord gives life and death. He's like, I can do that. And he killed one servant and let one go. He said, well, bring the sun from the west as Allah brings it from the east. So Ibrahim gave him a challenge that he couldn't do. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a challenge to his people, bring a surah that they couldn't do. So if you look at the mirroring of this, it's amazing. And it gives us that much more understanding of the Quran as we're following along, realizing there is... And this story is affecting us, even if we don't understand this, but it gives us that much more appreciation. It's like studying astronomy. You look up at the stars, the skies are beautiful. You look and you're amazed by the stars. But when you understand astronomy, you have a deeper appreciation. And one of the names of verses of the Quran, ayat, is actually najm. Is a najm, a nujum. In fact, some of the scholars said, when Allah swears by the mawaqi' al-nujum, the places or the setting of the stars, he's also swearing by the places that those stars, meaning the ayat, were revealed. So this is taken from a book called Structure and Quran Interpretation by Farrin, F-A-R-R-I-N, who's a scholar and a researcher of literature, Arabic literature, and the Quran specifically. And he eventually became Muslim. And there's others who have discussed this online and done some of the images that show that. Now, you have this entire surah follows this pattern. And even within the surah, you also find smaller areas where there's ring structure within that. So if we look at Ayat al-Kursi, and there's an image there that shows how Ayat al-Kursi also follows this. So the first part of it is Allah is saying, Allah, there is none worthy of worship except He, the ever-living, the ever-watchful. It mirrors directly to the last part of this of the ayah, and He is the most high, the most supreme. We take the next one. Neither drowsiness nor sleep overtakes Him. That mirrors the second to last, and their preservation tires Him not. The third part of the surah. To Him belongs whatever is in the heavens of the earth. That's mirrored to the third to last section of the ayah. His throne extends over the heavens and the earth. Fourth part of the ayah. Who is there that can intercede with Him except by His permission? Mirrored by, and they encompass not a thing, His knowledge, except for what He wills. And right there in the middle is the core, the heart of this ayah. He knows what is before them. And He knows what is after them. So subhanAllah, take a look at that the article that's linked. It has these images. It shows the structure that I discussed about Surah Al-Baqarah. And there's other surahs as well. In the next video, I'll discuss some more ayahs. And if you're interested, you can look at ring structure in the Quran or ring composition in the Quran. And you can learn more about this. Jazakumullah khair. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draw us all closer to His book. And may He give us better understanding of His book. And may He give us implementation of His book. Jazakumullah khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Allah.